Welcome to Westminster Presbyterian Church, those worshiping with us in person, and we want to welcome those worshiping with us online as well. We gather for worship tonight remembering Jesus' final meal with his disciples, where Jesus showed them the full extent of his love for them. The disciples were often confused by the way Jesus kept turning things upside down, upending the status quo, and that night in the upper room was no different. Jesus got up from the meal and radically changed the structure of that Passover feast by showing his disciples that the first can be last, and the last can be first. The disciples were shocked when Jesus, their master, took off his robe and wrapped a towel around him and washed their feet, taking the role of a servant. Jesus then tells them that he set an example for them, that they should also wash one another's feet, that they should be willing to take the role of a servant. And then Jesus gives them a new commandment, a mandate. As I have loved you, so also you ought to love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. My friends, as you are able and as you desire, let's stand and sing.
Thank you.
Will you join with me in the unison prayer? Gracious God, just as Jesus did, we live in times that teeter on the brink of catastrophe. At times we are stuck in our seats, hanging on for dear life to things that we mistake for security, things that keep us tied to the way things are, even if they aren't for the good. In this moment of quiet, we lift up to you those things we'd like to give up for good, for the sake of the good. Friends, the mercy of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting. I declare to you in the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. And as a people forgiven and set free, we reach out to lift others up, offering the peace of Christ, saying, "The peace of Christ be with you," and responding, "And also with you." And I invite you now to share the peace of Christ with those around you.
Scripture reading this evening comes from John's Gospel, the 13th chapter. We'll be looking at selected verses. So I invite you to listen to these words of Scripture and listen for God's Word to us this day. Now, before the Passover feast, Jesus knew that his hour had come to depart from this world and go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. Jesus and his disciples were sharing the evening meal. The devil had already put it into the heart of Judas, son of Simon Iscariot, to betray Jesus. Jesus knew that the Father had given all things into his hands, that he had come from the Father, and that he was returning to the Father. So Jesus got up from the table and took off his outer robe and tied a towel around himself. Then he poured water into a basin and began to wash his disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel that was tied around him. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus answered, "You do not know what I am doing now, but later you will understand." Peter said to him, "Lord, you will never wash my feet." And Jesus answered, "Unless I wash you, you have no share with me." After he had washed their feet, had put on his robe, and had returned to the table, Jesus said to them, "Do you know what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for that is what I am. So if I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I've set before you an example that you should also do as I have done to you. I give you a new commandment, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you also should love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another." May God bless this reading. May God bless our meditation on this, his word. I received a newsletter last week from John McCall. Some of you know John is a former pastor of this church. He has now served on the mission field in Taiwan for 27 years. John tells a story in that newsletter about a student of his who taught him a lesson about washing feet. John says he planned a Monday-Thursday service for the seminary community. And he asked one of his students, indigenous student Isis, to wash another student's feet during part of the service. John says it was a pretty full service. It had lots of liturgy to it, so he was a little bit worried about the time, that it might go on too long. But when the time came for Isis to wash another student's feet, he acted as if he had all the time in the world. He poured the water over the feet, slowly washed them, slowly dried them, and then he started to give a foot massage to this other student, oblivious to the time, as if nobody else was in the chapel. And John said he was surprised, but then transfixed. And he said to himself, "Here is your teacher about how to wash feet in Jesus' name." John said he realized in the past when he had washed someone else's feet in that kind of context, he'd often done it somewhat casually. He'd kind of wet their feet, and then he dried them off. But he said that Isa gave him this new vision. Whatever you do, do in love. And I think that's the lesson that Jesus is trying to teach his disciples on this night. I think it's the lesson he still tries to teach us. Whatever we do, do in love. John tells us that Jesus knows that his hour has come. Jesus knows that he will be betrayed. Jesus knows that later on this night he will be arrested, and then he will be crucified. And so before that happens, he wants to make sure that his disciples know just how much he loves them. And so during the middle of the meal that they were sharing, Jesus surprises everyone by getting up and taking off his robe and wrapping a towel around him and pouring water in the basin and then beginning to wash their feet. Now, washing feet was pretty common in this day. If you walked around on dusty roads all day long, if you wore sandals, you needed to wash your feet when you came into someone's home. So often the host at a gathering would provide water for people to wash their feet. If it was a wealthy house, there might be a servant who would wash your feet as you came in. And that's why Peter protests. Peter says that Peter thinks that this task of washing feet is beneath Jesus. Jesus is his teacher, his Lord. And he can't imagine Jesus stooping down and washing his feet. John, in that newsletter, has an interesting observation here. He says that he sees this as a beautiful story about Jesus' freedom. John says that in Jesus' culture, it was hierarchy and status were very important. And it's the same way in Taiwan, where John serves. John says the worst thing that can happen in Taiwan is if you lose face, that people begin to look down on you. And yet he says because Jesus knew that he was beloved by God, because Jesus knew that he had come from God and that he would return to God, Jesus was free to take this role of a servant, that he could kneel down and wash his disciples' feet, even though it went against all the expectations of that day. And John says that in the same way, when we know that we are beloved children of God, when we know that God loves us, then we are also free to serve others with a kind of freedom, with a kind of joy and abandon. He says that we know that our status does not come from what others think of us. Our status doesn't come from our position on the hierarchy. Our status comes from the God who created us, the God who redeems us, and the God who loves us with unconditional love. In our lesson, John says that Jesus loved his disciples to the end. That phrase can also be translated, he loved them completely. He loved them to the full. And I think both those things are true. Jesus loves his disciples to the end of his life. He loves them till his last breath. He also loves them to the full extent. He loves them unconditionally. He loves them completely with a kind of joy and abandon. And Jesus shows that love, expresses that love by washing their feet. And then he shows that love again by going to the cross and giving up his life for their sake and for the sake of the world. Now Jesus also says, as I have loved you, so also you should love one another. It's not enough for them to just know how much Jesus loves them. Jesus wants his love for them to inspire them to love each other. Jesus says, this is the way people will know that you are my disciples, by the way you love each other. That's the sign that we are followers of Christ, that we love others the same way Jesus has loved us. And I think that's a tall order, to try to love other people in the same way that Jesus loves us. But Jesus' love inspires us. Jesus shows us what this love looks like. And Jesus' love empowers us to love others. As I thought about this passage and the way Jesus shows his love for his disciples, I thought about the book that I sometimes use in premarital counseling called The Five Love Languages. You may have heard of that book. The author says there are different ways people express love and different ways people receive love, these different languages of love. And so he talks about five love languages: words of affirmation, quality time, acts of service for each other, touch, and gifts, some token of that love. Jesus shows his love for his disciples here with this humble act of service. But I think in some ways, Jesus shows his love in all five of those different love languages. There are also words of affirmation here. as I have loved you. There's quality time. Jesus sets aside time to spend with his disciples. There's touch, this act of washing their feet, an intimate act. There is a gift, the ultimate gift, the gift of his life. And so in the same way, there are many different ways that we can show love to other people. We can certainly express our love with humble acts of service for others. I feel like here at Westminster, there's no shortage of ways to serve others. Certainly hands-on mission projects and ways that we can care for each other. And it doesn't have to be through the ministries of the church, that every day we have opportunities to put the interest of others in front of our own, to take that role of a servant. We can also love others with the gift of our time. I feel like sometimes that's the best gift you can give someone, particularly in this age of busyness, and yet also a deep kind of loneliness. We can express love for others through our touch. That might be through a hug. It might be through a hand on a shoulder. It might be through taking a child on your lap or a grandchild onto your lap. We can show love to others through words of affirmation. Sometimes people just need to hear the words, I love you, or I'm proud of you, or they want you to ask about their day. I think our words can be powerful expressions of love. And certainly we can show our love through gifts of all sorts. During this Lenten season, we've invited you to share gifts through our Lent Mission Challenge, and you've done that in generous ways. Dale Bruner says that Jesus knows on this night that the primary way he will impact the world is through his disciples. And that's why Jesus thinks it's so important for them to understand his love, to experience his love. It's why Jesus spends so much time with his disciples in these last hours of his life. It's these disciples who will not just carry his message, but also carry his love. It's through their love that others will experience Christ's love. And now I think that's up to us. The way that others will know we are his disciples is as we love one another and reach out to love in the world. This is how they will know how much Jesus loves them. They will know by our love. Amen.
Thank you.
the end of Jesus' earthly life felt anything but uplifting to those that loved him and ate with him that night. But Jesus already knew that this was the only way to truly show us how to love one another completely. Jesus did not ignore the suffering or the brokenness of the world. Jesus entered into our suffering and our brokenness, knowing that only love can bring healing, the kind of sacrificial love which lifts up others, even at great cost. And so we come to this night with sorrow for the world, sorrow for all those who have lost loved ones, just as those around that table were about to lose their beloved teacher and friend. Yet we come knowing the rest of the story, that the upended can become the uplifted in the realm of God.
Let's look to God in prayer. God, you have formed us in your image and filled us with the breath of life. When we turn away, your love remains steadfast. You delivered your people from captivity and made covenant to be our sovereign God. You spoke to us through the prophets. And then in the fullness of time, you sent your Son and our Savior, Jesus Christ. At his baptism, your Spirit anointed him to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to announce that the time had come when you would save your people. Jesus upended the status quo at every turn, choosing love and healing before all else. He healed the sick, fed the hungry, ate with sinners, and humbled himself as a servant to wash the feet of his friends. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made a new covenant with us by water and the Spirit. God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us, gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them to be for us the body and blood of Christ, so that we may be the body of Christ for the world. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, and one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory, and we shall feast at his heavenly banquet. Hear us now as we pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
On the night which he gave himself up for us, Jesus took bread, and he broke it, and he gave thanks, and he gave it to his disciples, and he said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When supper was over, he took the cup and he gave thanks, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood and the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me."
My friends, the table is ready, but we come tonight not only to receive the sacrament of communion, We also come to remember this act of Jesus as he washed his disciples' feet. And so as you are invited to come forward down the center aisle, we'll invite you to pause as you come to the bowl with water to try to imagine someone whose feet you can't quite imagine washing. Maybe even somebody whose hands you can't quite imagine taking in friendship. And as you think about that person, imagine what kind of upturning, what kind of radical change it might take for you to find right relationship with that person, for you to find that relationship set right. And let that be a moment of confession about how difficult it is for us to really grasp the depth of Jesus' love, how difficult it is for us to follow the way he shows us, to serve even those who seem unredeemable to us. And then as you come forward, we invite you to just touch the water and let that be a reminder that renewal and reconciliation can happen. And then you'll turn to receive the sacraments, and that be an assurance that no matter where you are on that journey, there is grace for you. Jesus fed all. Jesus invited all, even those who betrayed him. And that is the most upending, radical grace of all. And it's ultimately that grace that lifts us up and allows us to lift up others as well. The table is ready. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Amen.
Thank you.
After the benediction, I will invite you to stay for just a few moments of reflection during our closing song and for the stripping of the table and the church. This is an ancient practice of the church that points to this stripping of the table, points to the desolation, the sense of abandonment that Jesus felt. So we remember that Jesus was stripped of his clothing in the same way the elements from the communion table will be removed, and then a black cloth draped across it. After the music is over, we'll then invite you to leave in silence. As our charge this evening, we'd invite you to hear these words from 1 John 4, 10 through 12. In this is love, not that we loved God, but that God loved us and sent his Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Beloved, since God loved us so much, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God. If we love one another, God abides in us, and his love is perfected in us. And now may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and mind in the knowledge and love of God, and of his Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be with you now and always. Amen.